Yet another exciting group on our campus comes with our College of Engineering and Mines. And today we're joined by Dr. Brian Tandy, the Dean of the College, Dan Lodel, who is a research professor and the executive director of the CEM Research Institute, and Satar Dornan, who is an assistant professor of civil engineering and the director of the Transportation Technology Research Institute. How about a round of applause for them? So, Brian, we've talked a lot about connections today. For the College of Engineering and Mines, one big collaborative effort is the new Aerospace Engineering Program, which launched this fall and combines the work in engineering also with the work in the John D. Odegard School of Aerospace Sciences. Can you tell us a little bit about this initiative?
Sure, I'm happy to. In my mind, aerospace engineering at UND has been really a long time coming. UND, as we all know, has a very strong national brand around aviation, around space. We have great connections with the Air Force, the Space Force, the Space Development Agency, with Grand Sky. There's just 100 reasons why aerospace engineering is a great fit for UND. And what I'm really proud about is that this is a true collaboration with our colleagues in the School of Aerospace. Faculty in aviation and space studies will be teaching some of the required and elective courses in the program, and I think it's just going to create a whole lot of great opportunities for collaboration and really interesting projects between our engineering students and aerospace students.
That's fantastic. So that's on programs. Now there's facilities things happening as well, and UND is looking at building a new STEM facility on our campus, which would combine engineering and other sciences together, like math, physics, biology, and so forth. And this would be built where Hislop currently stands, right outside the window here. And while this marks the end of an important phase and the contributions of the Hislop Center, there's a lot to be excited about with this new facility. Can you tell us a little bit about what to expect?
Sure, I'm happy to. So if you walk around our buildings where we teach our math, science, and engineering programs, you'll see a lot of outdated spaces. I mean, these buildings have served us really well over the years. I'm talking about Harrington, Upson, Whitmer, Abbott. But they're really not designed for the type and the scale of research and education that we do today. So after several years of planning, we decided to pursue a STEM complex on the Hislop site. As you mentioned, we went into the legislative session with this as our top priority, and we're really thankful that the legislature approved funding for the first phase of this project. So as we originally conceived it, it was one phase for engineering, one phase for those math and science programs out of arts and sciences. But after discussions with my colleague in arts and sciences, Brad Rundquist, we really realized that if all we did was build an engineering building attached to a science building, we would have missed a huge opportunity to do something more interesting and more innovative. So the new vision for the building, the complex rather, is an integrated math, science, and engineering complex that will really be, in my mind, the physical embodiment of this spirit of collaboration that we've had on campus over the last several years.
That's wonderful. And you mentioned the great support from the legislature. That's true. They also expect us to have a donor component as well. At least 30% of the project is going to be privately funded through donors.
Absolutely. It's a heavy lift, but this is all about the future of math, science, and engineering at UND. And I think we've got a lot of support from our alumni and from our corporate partners as well. So we're excited about it.
Awesome. And you mentioned the great programs that are happening. One of those projects is led by Dan Lodel, who works with rare earth elements. We've read about these in the newspaper. For someone who doesn't know, Dan, about these, what are they?
Well, if we squint a little bit and try to remember back to our high school chemistry class, at the bottom of the periodic table, there are two rows of elements that are separated from the rest. The rare earth elements are at the top of that table. They've got goofy names like dysprosium and praseodymium. What really makes them interesting and important are their unique properties. And those properties make them truly irreplaceable in an incredible variety of consumer products and applications. Things like your smartphones and computer drives, but also military systems and energy systems. But the challenge is that our domestic supply chains right now are heavily reliant on foreign countries to be able to supply our needs. The federal government recognizes this as a risk. So they've been funding R&D, aggressively ramping up R&D funding over the past several years to help address it. And at UND, the College of Engineering and Mines, along with our partners at the EERC, have been fortunate enough to receive some of this early funding.
Yeah, and the early funding you mentioned, we you have received a grant for about $8 million, just $1 short of that, believe it or not, which is the first phase of a potential $250 million grant from the federal government, and a huge opportunity both economically, but also for us to make a contribution to national security. So what's on the horizon here for this particular grant?
Yeah, thank you. Little context first. In this country right now, it's really difficult to permit a new mine and open a new mine. But at the same time, to fill our supply chain needs, we need new mining. We need expanded mining. One potential solution to that is to leverage existing operations and existing mining facilities. North Dakota has an opportunity here with our lignite coal industry. Our research at UND over the past 7 or 8 years now has identified lignite as a promising new resource for rare earth elements. And we've been scaling up a process technology over those 7 or 8 years to the point now where we have a pilot scale facility in commissioning. And as you mentioned, we're just about to kick off this new program with the DOE in a first phase, which is the engineering and design phase and business planning phase for a commercial plant that would commercialize this technology. We're gonna be competing with one other team out of West Virginia for a next phase, the $250 million project that would actually build and operate this plant in North Dakota. So truly exciting opportunity, and I'm thrilled to be a part of it.
Nice. And Satar, your work within transportation and civil engineering has been extraordinary. You're the director of the Transportation Technology Research Institute, which was funded by the UND Department, the North Dakota Department of Transportation. So the two main goals are increasing the number of engineers in the transportation enterprise, as well as performing research. And so what types of hands-on learning and research are you doing as part of this institute?
Thank you, President Armacost. Basically, we're trying to help the North Dakota Department of Transportation in filling the gaps in critical areas of engineers in transportation enterprise. That includes advanced structural engineering design, like precast, pre-SRS concrete, sustainable material, and more interesting one, getting engineers into unmanned aerial system world by getting them trained and work on the related transportation-related project at TTRI.
Nice, and of course, the close connection to artificial intelligence and UAS, certainly there's a benefit to the work, but certainly even more so a benefit to the local community about these technologies.
Yes, absolutely. I think our community, our city, can greatly benefit from non-contact sensing and autonomous system. What they are robotic platforms equipped with artificial intelligence, and you can do a lot of cool things with them, from construction monitoring, from flood mitigation techniques, from any type of fast, remote, and robust monitoring. We can do it with AI and unmanned aerial systems.
Nice. And one other really cool project that you and your team are working on, and you've all seen 3D printers, right? You've heard of these. You're doing 3D printing with concrete. So tell us more about the types of things that you're building and how that works and the compliance issues and so forth.
Yes, I'm very excited about this project because we're probably among a handful of universities that have that capability in the United States. And second of all, we're investigating building structural elements besides walls that have been historically used or 3D printing has been used to build them. So we're using it for constructing culverts, underground culverts. Also, we're probably going to have our students competing at ASCE, maybe next year, for a concrete canoe that we're going to 3D print, and hopefully we're going to win.
Concrete canoes do float.
They
right?
do.
But, you know, a life without rebar is not a life at all.
No rebar.
Right?
No.
So, no rebar.
So that's
no
the
rebar.
Challenging part. Yeah, thanks for bringing
that's
it
right.
up. That's right. Yeah, no rebar in the 3D printing.
No so, rebar in yeah. 3D printing. So yeah. All of our construction folks here are kind of crossing their eyes on this one.
But, I know, me too.
Yeah, great work. Well, you get a sense of this sense of discovery, this love of discovery that is existing. I think when we talk about rare earth elements, we've got three rare elements on this stage. We've got now tandium, lodalium, and satarium. So our new three rare earth elements. How about a round of applause?
Thank you.